Serious gardeners dream about growing that special mutation that will become world famous. Well, I came close this summer. In this video, I'll tell you all about my mutated pyloric foxglove. And at the end of the video, I'll show you some other types of plants that also form these monsters, including my monster orchid. A few weeks ago, I walked outside and immediately spotted this unusual foxglove. It's a creamy white color, growing in a fairly shady spot where the color just glows. But what made it really stand out is the large, uncharacteristic flower at the top of the inflorescence, i.e. the flower stem. This type of flower is not unknown, but it is a rare occurrence. Carl Linnaeus, the botanist who formalized the binomial naming system for species, was also aware of this mutation. This was long before genetics was understood, and he considered the plant to be an unnatural monster. So he called it a pyloric, which means monster in Greek. In a normal foxglove, flower buds are formed at the bottom of the flower stem, and as the stem gets longer, it forms more and more buds until the plant decides it's produced enough. The buds start opening from the bottom. The pyloric form of foxglove forms normal buds at the bottom, but then it forms one monstrous flower at the top, which stops the stem from growing any taller. This unusual flower opens before most of the other buds. A normal foxglove flower has bilateral symmetry, where the left side mirrors the right side through a vertical axis. I've drawn a red line through this axis. You can see the left side is a mirror image of the right. The pyloric flower shows radial symmetry. You can draw any number of axes through the flower, and the two halves mirror each other. The genetics of pyloric foxgloves was deciphered 100 years ago. It is controlled by a simple Mendelian recessive gene. If you cross a pyloric plant with itself, all of the offspring will be pyloric. If it is crossed with a fully normal plant, all of the F1 offspring, i.e. the next generation, will look normal, but they'll carry the recessive gene, and this is then expressed in the F2 generation. It is a bit more complicated than this because pyloric plants don't always form the top flower, in which case the plant looks quite normal. It is not clear exactly what causes the expression of the gene, but the environment plays an important role. You may need the right light and temperature conditions before the top flower shows itself, indicating that this is probably an epigenetic effect. This is the first pyloric plant that I have ever found in the garden, and the weather this year has been very unusual. It was very cold and wet. Maybe this is what triggered it. All the flowers on a pyloric plant, including the top one, will produce seed that contains the recessive gene. Since foxgloves are biennial, flowering in the second year, this particular plant may not come back next year, so I'll collect the seed and see if I can produce more of it. This is the only white, creamy-colored pyloric foxglove pictured on the internet, but there are pictures of other colors, such as this pink one. Pylorism also occurs in orchids. This is a pyloric phalaenopsis, similar to one I grew many years ago. The normal flat petals have taken on the characteristics of the lip. Now you see three lips instead of the normal one. This is another phal that is blooming for me right now. It is also considered pyloric, but the two petals are only cupped and don't look a lot like the lip. You can think of this as a partial pyloric. Pylorism also happens in snapdragons. This picture compares a normal flower with a pyloric one. The garden is full of weird and wonderful things. Keep your eye open, and you just might discover the next hot mutation.
If you enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up. And if you want to see more videos like this, hit the subscribe button below, and then the little bell so you get notified. Thank you very much.